the night before the feast. The room is ready for our friends. We gather here, this watch we keep. Waiting here, filled with fear. Waiting here for our friends. It isn't safe for him, we know. Betrayal hastens to the door. Which one of us will it be? I only hope it isn't me. Good evening. It's good that you can join us on this Maundy Thursday. Normally we would be meeting in the little chapel at Robborough, and we look forward to the times when we can do that. But perhaps you want to prepare yourself with your bread, your wine, for our sharing in the Lord's Supper later. As we begin our service together, Marianne will call us to worship.
Jesus predicts Peter's denial. When he was gone, Jesus said, "Now is the Son of Man glorified, and God is glorified in him. If God is glorified in him, God will glorify the Son in himself, and will glorify him at once. My children, I will be with you only a little longer. You will look for me, and just as I told the Jews, so I tell you now, where I am going, you cannot come. A new command I give you, love one another. As I have loved you, so you must love one another. By this all men will know that you are my disciples, if you love one another." Thanks be to God.
My Savior's love to me.
My song is Love Unknown. How amazing a hymn that is. So Margaret will lead us in prayer.
Let us pray. The heart of the journey. With death foreshadowed you knelt. A servant embracing, cleansing, blessing the touch of love. With betrayal in the air you lay at the table. A rabbi listening, teaching, feeding the word of life. With the journey set, you waited, the Son of God, weeping, praying, pleading, the light of the world. Amen.
This reading is taken from St. John's Gospel, chapter 13, beginning at verse 1. It was now the day before the Passover festival. Jesus knew that the hour had come for him to leave this world and go to the Father. He had always loved those in the world who were his own, and he loved them to the very end. Jesus and his disciples were at supper. The devil had already put the thought of betraying Jesus into the heart of Judas, the son of Simon Iscariot. Jesus knew that the Father had given him complete power. He knew that he had come from God and was going to God. So he rose from the table, took off his outer garment, and tied a towel round his waist. Then he poured some water into a wash basin and began to wash the disciples' feet and dry them with the towel around his waist. He came to Simon Peter, who said to him, "Are you going to wash my feet, Lord?" Jesus answered him, "You do not understand now what I am doing, but you will understand later." Peter declared, "Never at any time will you wash my feet." "If I do not wash your feet," Jesus answered, "you will no longer be my disciple." Simon Peter answered, "Lord, do not wash only my feet then, wash my hands and head too." Jesus said, "Anyone who has taken a bath is completely clean and does not have to wash himself except for his feet. All of you are clean, all except one." Jesus already knew who was going to betray him. That is why he said, "All of you except one are clean." After Jesus had washed their feet, he put his outer garment back on and returned to his place at the table. "Do you understand what I have just done to you?" he asked. "You call me teacher and Lord, and it is right that you do so, because that is what I am. I, your Lord and teacher, have just washed your feet. You then should wash one another's feet. I have set an example for you, so that you will do just what I have done for you." Thanks be to God.
This night, a night of new opportunity, a night of fond remembrances, a night of incredible closeness, and a night of infinite distance. Around a table, just like so many other celebrations, the young men gathered, perhaps reminiscing, wondering what the future might hold. And for at least two of the men present, the certainty, missing in all the others, the knowledge that this would be the last such night. It doesn't matter that the Gospels tell it differently, that John has the moment of washing, such an outstanding experience, that we might want to question the others, ask why did they miss it, or how come it isn't there. Although of all the Gospels, it would be in John that we might expect to find such a story. It is this Gospel that shares with us the notion of Jesus as a revelation of God. This Gospel, which moves between heaven and earth with breathtaking ease, it has incarnation, the Word becoming flesh, at its heart. But washing, the task of the servant, it clearly emphasises the sense that Jesus has about humbling oneself, especially for the sake of others. And I wonder, are we seeing an impulsive Jesus? Such a thought may spring to mind when we look at when Jesus washes the feet of his disciples. See, before the meal will clearly indicate the role of servant and the humility Jesus demonstrates. But in the mealtime, why? Breaking the circle to serve is perhaps demonstrative of the action we may need to take in our own lives. You know, the moments when we think we could be elders or we could take up a role in our shared journey of discipleship. But Jesus takes this moment, ends the who is the greatest thinking by embodying the least. It is his living example that can move us to become living examples of the love of God today. So if you want to make sense of taking out the Christian aid envelopes, the church flowers, the baptismal and birthday cards, or simply visiting our housebound disciples, see it as a gift of this night, where washing the feet of the weary has a living water effect on our service. Jesus washes all their feet, Judas too, lifting his heel from the ground, needing perhaps that depth of washing we too can need. It is a great comfort when we feel we're betraying Jesus, letting down God in our holding back of ourselves. I want to need his compassion to flow into the cracked and broken parts of my life, not just as cleanser, but as life-restoring, life-saving, life-giving water, flowing not just from his hands to my feet, but to my whole body, all of me and all of everyone who in that washing may come to know him, and in doing so, have brokenness mended, dirtiness cleansed, in such a way that new life can spring up where living for self has been. Impulsive Christ, change us, renew us, we are yours. Thanks be to God. Amen. When Jesus had washed their feet, this meeting of friends became something very different. And he took a piece of the bread that had been set aside for this purpose. He gave thanks for the bread, for all that it is. He blessed it and broke it and said to them, "When you're together in fellowship, do this to remember me." So let's eat together. They usually drank wine after supper, and so Jesus took the cup of wine, gave thanks to God for all that it is, and said to those of his friends, "When you drink this, call me to mind, for this wine is a blessing to our fellowship. in drinking bread and wine together. They were not simply to reflect upon the past, but to call his living spirit into the present, to enrich their lives together. And we pray that that will continue throughout the world today. In Jesus' name.
Let us pray. Loving God, for the precious gift of life that you've given to us, we give you thanks. For the enduring presence of your love in this world, we give you thanks. For the knowledge that you're with us at the close of the day, we give you thanks. On this day, we hear the message that it is better to serve than to be served. On this day, we journey in hope as we trust in your promise. As we journey into the final few days of the week that we call holy, we are conscious that we share in the life of the world. We are conscious of the presence of those who are near to us and of those from whom we are apart. Whether near or far, embrace us all with your love. Lord, we are conscious of others whose life and work is woven into the fabric of our society, and upon whom we depend, those who serve us, especially at this time. And we pray for them, for delivery drivers and posties, for refuse collectors and cleaners, for shop workers and care workers. Protect them and keep them safe. For nurses and doctors, for scientists and surgeons, for midwives and ambulance drivers, protect them and watch over them. For those who govern on our behalf, for those who make decisions that impact upon us all, for all who shape our common life, protect them and increase their wisdom and understanding. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And grant us faith to journey into the days and weeks to come, through the wilderness of despair and anguish and hurt, into the dawning realization of new life, new hope, and new dawn, as we are assured of the presence of the crucified and risen Christ. May we be more like him. Amen.
Thank you, Jane, for those prayers. We're going to sing Beauty for Brokenness.
Salvation and bring you their praise.